students, in the last class we learned about ozone layer depletion, and in this class let us study a case study of air pollution, which is the Bhopal gas tragedy or the Bhopal disaster. The Bhopal gas tragedy is the tragic gas leak incident on the night of 2nd December or the early hours of 3rd December in 1984 at Bhopal, Madhya Pradesh. In this incident, several lakhs of the city residents were exposed to 30 to 40 tons of the highly toxic methyl isocyanate gas and small amounts of phosgene, etc., which leaked from the Union Carbide India Limited pesticide plant in Bhopal. It is regarded as the world's worst industrial disaster, in which 20,000 people died, 1,000 people became blind, and more than 1 lakh people continue to suffer from various illnesses. In the Bhopal Union Carbide India Limited, the insecticide carbaryl was manufactured by the reaction between methyl isocyanate or MIC and alpha naphthol. The MIC for the process was prepared from methyl amine and phosgene, and it was stored in a large storage tank at the plant. So this is phosgene and this is methyl isocyanate. Methyl isocyanate, when reacted with alpha naphthol, gives the carbaryl, the insecticide carbaryl. MIC is highly reactive and it can react with several active hydrogen containing compounds including water. It is assumed that water had entered the tank and some catalytic material had initiated a violent exothermic reaction between MIC and water, leading to very high pressure and the violent bursting of the tank. The inquiries that followed the incident revealed that it had resulted from a total breakdown of the safety measures at the plant and the negligence of the authorities. In the first place, the plant dealing such toxic material should not have been allowed to function in a heavily populated area like Bhopal. Further, MIC in the tank was filled to 87% of its capacity, while the maximum permissible level was 50%. Also, MIC was not stored at 0 degree centigrade but around 20 degree centigrade, as the cooling systems had been shut down about 5 months before the incident. Also, the scrubber, which could have neutralized the gas with caustic soda, had failed to work because it did not contain caustic soda. Also, the flare tower, where the gas could have been burnt off, also had failed to work. The safety valves, vital gauges and indicators in the tank were very defective. So this is the flare tower that was present in the Union Carbide Company Limited, and it was not at all working. The scrubber was also not working and the refrigeration system was also not working. This is the scrubber. You can see the outline of the factory. Okay, so this is a Bhopal gas tragedy incident. Now let us discuss what are the methods to control air pollution. Many steps should be taken to control air pollution. One is that better automobile engines should be designed to ensure complete combustion of the fuel. Another one is that use of gaseous fuels should be ensured rather than liquid or solid fuels, because they completely combustion with air. Also, we have to attach electrostatic precipitators to exhaust, industrial exhaust and also automobile exhaust. Also, the height of chimney should be raised. Furnace fuels of low sulfur content should be used in power plants, industries, etc., so that pollution can be minimized. Also, gaseous pollutants should be absorbed or dissolved in a device called scrubber. Also, excessive use of pesticides and chlorofluorocarbons should be prevented. The next one is cigarette smoking should be banned in all public places. And always we have to plant more and more trees so that the carbon dioxide balance is kept intact. So these are the ways by which we can control air pollution. Next is water pollution. Water pollution is the contamination of water by foreign substances or agents which alter its quality and characteristics. Major reason for water pollution is human activities. And the major sources of water pollution include domestic waste for urban and rural areas, industrial effluents, agricultural runoff water, which are discharged into our natural water bodies like rivers, lakes, ponds, etc. There are two types of sources of pollution. One is the point source of pollution and the other is the non-point source of pollution. Sources of pollution that are easily identified are called point sources. Example include municipal and industrial discharge pipes. We can exactly know the location of the pollution. That is called a point source. Places of pollution that cannot be easily identified are called non-point sources. Example are agricultural runoff water and rainwater drainage. So we cannot actually pinpoint where the source of pollution occurs. A water pollutant is a substance, agent or factor that degrades the quality of water. Examples for water pollutants are sewage, detergents, toxic heavy metals, domestic waste, fertilizers, pesticides, organic substances, etc. So let us discuss the reasons for water pollution one by one. First is sewage and domestic waste. Domestic waste are discarded materials produced from individual human activities. They consist of organic waste along with inorganic waste coming out of houses, hotels, religious institutions, etc. Sewage consists of organic and inorganic waste matter of the community carried by water. Domestic sewage contains a large quantity of soaps and detergents and also human and animal excreta. Sewage imparts color and foaming in the water body that it enters and causes turbidity. As sewage contains human and animal excreta, it is the carrier of several pathogenic microorganisms like E. coli bacteria, Streptococcus bacteria, and several other viruses. That means typhoid, paratyphoid, cholera, polio, etc. are waterborne diseases. Also, organic pollution of water by sewage causes dissolved oxygen depletion because the microbes degrade the organic substances by aerobic bacteria and they consume dissolved oxygen. So, this can lead to the destruction of aquatic life like fish. As anaerobic bacteria also can break down the organic waste present in sewage, chemicals that have a foul smell and are harmful to human health are produced. Thus, sewage gives a foul odor or stench to water as well as gives toxicity. Soaps introduced into water bodies are easily degraded by microorganisms but they are hydrolyzed to corresponding fatty acids, which increase the organic content of water. And this leads to the depletion of dissolved oxygen content in water, destroying aquatic life. Many detergents introduced into water bodies, like the tetrapropylene benzyl sulfonate category, are not fully biodegradable by microorganisms and will persist for a long time in water, and this will cause pollution. Also, sewage contains huge quantities of nutrients in the form of nitrogen and phosphorus. This can lead to eutrophication, which favors algal growth and algal bloom. Eutrophication is the contamination of water resulting from phosphate and nitrate-rich fertilizers. These make freshwater bodies nutrient-rich, and this favors algal growth and results in algal bloom. The process in which water bodies get nutrient-rich, thereby supporting massive algal growth, is known as eutrophication. So this is the algal growth, and this is the fish, suffocation of fish, and the sunlight is blocked because of the layer of algae present on the water surface. So this algae grows due to the rich content in nitrates from fertilizers, which come from fertilizers used in agriculture. Now let us discuss water pollution by industrial effluents. Industrial effluents discharge into our freshwater bodies have the greatest potential to pollute water. Effluents from pulp and paper mills, sugar factories, chemical plants, pharmaceutical plants, dairies, distilleries, etc. pollute water bodies with organic matter. The effluents from fertilizer industries also release quantities of nutrients into water bodies, causing eutrophication. Waste released into water from metal plating industries contain large quantities of heavy metals and cyanide. Also, effluents from chemical factories contain acidic and alkyl compounds, which make water corrosive and thus harmful to aquatic life. Paper mills release effluents containing mercury compounds, which are used as fungicides. These are highly poisonous. Also, radioactive waste discharged into water from uranium plants and atomic energy plants cause radiation pollution. Effluents from pesticide factories contain pesticide chemicals, which are highly toxic to all types of living organisms. Industrial chemicals like polychlorinated biphenyls and detergents add to the list of water pollutants present in industrial effluents. Now let us discuss water pollution by agricultural discharge. Water leaving from fields as a result of irrigation activities, rain, melted snow, etc. is referred to as agricultural runoff. In agriculture runoff, two extremely harmful kinds of pollutants are the pesticides and the fertilizers. Pesticides like DDT, lindane, malathion, parathion, bagon, etc. used in agricultural fields enter our water bodies and pollute the water bodies. Once the pesticides enter into the aquatic ecosystem, they concentrate in all components of the system. As most of them are persistent pollutants, they remain in water persistently and they enter into the food chain through bacteria and other aquatic organisms. They tend to bioaccumulate, and this process is called biomagnification. Biomagnification is the process in which a stable or non-biodegradable persistent pollutant increases in concentration at a higher trophic level as it is passed successively from one organism to another through the food chain. So in organisms placed at the end of the food chain, like fish, aquatic birds, and man, they are liable to accumulate at a very high concentration. And so they are highly toxic. The chlorinated hydrocarbons mainly affect the central nervous system, and they can cause cancers, hypertension, sterility, damage to kidney, and death at higher concentrations. Pesticide pollution that had resulted from the spraying of endosulfan, a highly toxic organochlorine pesticide, in the cashew plantations of Kasaragod, has caused various diseases and endless human sufferings to the people there. The effects include mental retardation, physical deformities, cancer, birth disorders, infertility, cerebral palsy, epilepsy, and damages to the brain and nervous system. So the use of highly persistent pesticides should be replaced by less persistent pesticides. When the use of a persistent pesticide is necessary, its use should be restricted to the minimum. Also, effluents from pesticide factories should be treated by suitable methods. Also, we can use natural pesticides like petroleum products or plant products like tobacco preparation, neem and turmeric extracts, etc. This we can make in our home and use for our plants. Contamination of water by fertilizers can also lead to undesirable effects like eutrophication, which you have already studied. Also, contamination of water by fertilizers can cause blue baby syndrome. When water is polluted with nitrites and is consumed by humans, nitrates are reduced to nitrites by intestinal bacteria. Nitrites can cause the serious child diseases, methemoglobinemia or blue baby syndrome, in which nitrite interferes with the oxygen carrying capacity of blood, causing suffocation and damage to respiratory and vascular systems. So pregnant women drinking contaminated water can have child which are blue in color, and this is called blue baby syndrome. So these are the after effects of water contaminated by fertilizers and pesticides. And the next class we will learn water pollution by toxic metals. Thank you.